very talented people here for you today of a different caliber. So you know, because I've been sending the emails for literally weeks, your vote matters. And today, you're going to hear about policies, not personalities. And that's why they're in. So I have great pleasure in handing over right now to your principal, Dave Shaw.
To welcome the five candidates here today, and the fact that they've come here, given up their time, shows their commitment to young people, and I admire all of them for doing that. On the TV, we've seen quite a lot of low-quality TV debates. At Bilborough, we can be better than that, can't we? Yeah, so we've asked all the candidates to talk about their policies, and to talk positively and not to insult each other. And we'd ask you, if you hear something you like, give it a round of applause, by all means. And if you really like it, give it a really loud round of applause. Save the booing and the hissing and the cheering for the pantomime, okay? This is about policy.
I don't have time to ask one anymore.
Thank you very much for all coming, showing your involvement, getting involved in politics. That is what it's all about. And I hope you find something today to inspire you, whether you go into the ballot box or whether you'll be going in a few years' time. So, I'm going to hand over now to each of the candidates to give a 3-minute introduction to who they are and what they stand for, and then we'll start taking the questions. The questions have been written by the students, and they'll be asked by the students. So I'd like to start by asking Darren to come up and give his 3-minute address. Round of applause for Darren, please.
Served 26 years in the Royal Air Force. Can you believe that? 26 years. Now, I would recommend the Royal Air Force to anyone. It was a smashing career and I really, really loved it, so give it some thought. But the military posted me away from my family home, which is just around the corner in Nuttall. They posted me around the world, and I also did a tour in Iraq. Now, after I left the forces, I also worked to provide NHS services for a hospital. And then I was also general manager of a food distribution business. Now, it's only the Conservative Party that can unleash the potential for Britain. And only then it will happen post-Brexit. We need to get Brexit done. It's quite popular. We need to respect that the people of Broxtowe, I'm in the Broxtowe constituency, but the people in the Bilborough area, and also the country, voted to leave. When I served in the forces, I served to defend democracy. And then we can move on after Brexit. And with a strong economy, local businesses can grow. And we can invest in things like rebuilding the Queen's Medical Centre, the NHS, and also police, and also schools. So vote Darren Henry for getting things done.
Next, I'd like to invite Greg Marshall for Labour to come up and give his...
Thank you very much, Bilborough. Thank you for inviting me back. I had the most wonderful time when I was here in 2017 and got within 800 votes of being elected not a stone's throw from here for Broxtowe. And I am asking each and every one of you to support me this time around as we can unite the country, bring us together on the issues that matter to you and take ourselves forward. This is a young people's election. Because the issues that we will be talking about in the election will affect each and every one of you in the room now and for generations to come. Whether that is the climate crisis, whether that is in our relationship with our European friends and our neighbours, whether we want to be isolationist and inward looking or outward looking and joining countries and communities together. The issues matter now more than ever. And the Labour Party is the one to offer those solutions. So, if it's about a national education service, which will scrap tuition fees, which will reintroduce the education maintenance allowance, then the Labour Party is for you. If it's about ending poverty pay for young people, about having £10 an hour, about scrapping 0 hours contracts, then the Labour Party is for you. We've had too much of precarious employment, too much uncertainty. If it is about council housing, if it is about opportunity, if it is about building council-owned council housing and providing young people with a place to live and security into the future, then the Labour Party is for you. And the other parties don't have any answers. They will say, one by one, that the Labour Party is this, and the Labour Party is that, and they will decry the policies that we're standing at. I'm saying they've had 9 years to change things in this country. And if we're happy with that, and that we deserve change now, and the Labour Party is offering real change. So you will have a choice. You will have a choice that matters for the biggest time in 40 years in this country. Whether you want a Johnson, Trump, Farage direction of the world, or whether you want hope and opportunity and unity under a Labour government and under a Jeremy Corbyn-led Labour government.
Thank you very much. Next up, we have got Brent Poland for representing the Green Party.
First of all, I'm one of the other parties. I've never been in government. I've not messed up the system. I've been a teacher for 16 years. I'm tired. I'm standing here because I'm tired of the same old, same old. I'm tired of the same messages. I know Jeremy Corbyn's a nice guy, but you know what? He's been in Parliament for 30, 40 years, and what has he done? I'm sorry. Not good enough. They've had their chance. You Labour, old Labour, you Conservative, old Conservative, I am sick and tired of the same old messages, drum beats every generation. Your whole education system has been one experiment from a Labour government to a Conservative government. 1-9. Your teachers put under pressure. I've seen colleagues of mine broken down and beaten. I've seen your staff go on strike because they haven't had the correct funding. Both parties have fundamentally failed when it comes to education. Then it comes to opportunities. Social mobility has got bigger. I am not just about the environment. That's what we Greens get labelled, an inconvenient afterthought. Everybody else is coming over to our side. We're the original environmental party. We're the original equality party. We're the original party that gives people fairness, justice, equality and rights. My parents stood in the streets of Northern Ireland and fought for one person, one vote. I am here now because I got an opportunity that you're not going to get at university. I got to go free to university. You should not be discriminated against for wanting to better yourself. You should be encouraged. Shame on all these parties. They have market forces, they have capitalized your education system, and they have turned you into data spreadsheets. You are now a product, not a human being. They have done all this, and I'm stepping outside them, and I'm standing outside that system. Nothing wrong except try and educate young people and inspire them. And I've got some of my ex-people here. And if you want to ask them, am I normally like this? This is a normal lesson. And despite government cutbacks, despite all what they have done, I still stand in front of young people with hope, because you are amazing. I am tired of hearing snowflakes. I am tired when children go on strike. You are condemned for taking action. You have every right to stand up for yourself, every right to be heard. Raise your hands if you're 16 or 17 years old. You don't get to vote, and that's not fair. Women didn't get the vote because they were told they couldn't decide. My parents didn't get the vote because they were the wrong religion. It's not fair. You're old enough to pay taxes, you're old enough to make up your own mind, you're old enough to vote, and we want to change that. We want to change proportional representation. I'll say is about Brexit. Listen to my accent. I get a text message when I go to my parents' house that says, "Welcome to the Republic of Ireland." When I go to the toilet, it says, "Welcome to the UK." Nobody can tell me yet what they want to do with that question. But I tell you what I want to do. We want to go back to the people and ask them again. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next, I'd like to introduce Robert Swift from the Liberal Democrats.
Good morning, Millbrae. Unfortunately, he just stole my best line, which is the Liberal Democrats also think you should all have the vote in this election. Because if you'd had the vote in 2016, we would not have voted to leave the EU. The Liberal Democrats in this election are standing to stop Brexit. This is the last chance. This is your last chance to stop Brexit and send this country down a plug hole of nationalism and isolationism. If we're going to fight climate change, we need to do it in partnership with our nearest neighbours. At the moment, you have the right to travel and live and love in 27 countries. I don't believe that should be taken away from you, especially with you never having the chance to even vote on that. You are the people most affected by this. So I hope that you can still help out in the campaign. I hope that some of you have the vote, because this is our last chance to stop Brexit. We want to spend a 50 billion Remain bonus from stopping Brexit on our public services. All these other parties that are going along with Brexit, they're making spending pledges that they cannot back up, because this country will be poorer after Brexit. We want to fight climate change. We want to make renewable energy 80% of your electricity by 2030. When the Liberal Democrats entered government in 2010, the Conservatives said to us, "Minister for Climate Change, we don't want that. You can do that one, it sounds boring." I have a friend called Ed Davey. When he took over that department, renewable energy was 3% of our mix. When we left in 2015, it was 20%. That was due to the largest offshore wind farm building project seen in Europe. The UK is now a world leader in offshore wind. So we have a track record on fighting climate change. We want to insulate every low-income home by 2025. We want to give every young person the best start in life by recruiting 20,000 more teachers as part of a 10 billion investment in schools. We want to make the economy fairer for you by regulating the gig economy better, by providing free childcare for 9 months. Also, we want to improve mental health services. It's not right that in Nottingham it takes 3 months to see a psychiatric nurse and 9 months to start treatment. Early intervention is everything. And the other parties will not say how they're going to pay for this. We want to put a penny on income tax to pay for a $6 billion investment in mental health services. And I think my time is up. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Robert. Finally, I'd like to hand over to Anna Soubry for the Independent Group for Change.
Thank you very much. Hello, Bilborough. Good to be back at Bilborough. My youngest daughter did her A-levels here, so I'm well familiar with this college, and I'm also well familiar with some of the difficulties that you faced over recent years. For the last 9 years, I've been the Member of Parliament for Broxton. It's been a great honour, great privilege. It's all well and good for a whole load of men stand up in front of you and make a whole load of promises without explaining how they are going to deliver them. And it's also important to realise this. This is arguably the most important election for many, many years. And the reason it's so important is because it's primarily about your future. Now, I have no difficulty in saying this, and I said it first on July the 29th, 2016. This country of ours made a terrible mistake when we voted to leave the European Union. Now, many of us were very upset about that result, but we knew that we'd had a referendum and we knew we had to get on and try and deliver the result. The simple truth of it is that any Brexit deal is bad for our country. It's bad for jobs and it's bad for your future. And that is why I'm a proud founding member of the People's Vote. I believe Brexit should go back to the people. One, because people are entitled to change their minds. Secondly, because now we know what it looks like, people are entitled to have that final say. And thirdly, young people who couldn't vote in 2016 have a right to a say over something that will affect them more than anybody else. I am proud to be standing again with the support of Liberal Democrats, even Green voters, members of the Labour Party, and former Conservatives, and even Leave voters. And these young men may find that amusing. But the reality is this. The two main countries, parties of our country, are on the grips of extremes. Yesterday, 74 officials of the Labour Party explained the level of anti-Semitism in the Labour Party that drove out Jewish MPs, and I'm sorry that you think that's funny and you applaud it, because it's a serious problem about the state of the Labour Party in the grips of the extremes. And Greg Marshall is one of Jeremy Corbyn's biggest supporters. And the Conservative Party is led by Boris Johnson, who's insulted just about everybody. Single mothers. He's even insulted Muslim women who choose to win the veil. If you want a better country that unites our country, wherever you live, then vote for moderate centrists and vote against the extremists who are dividing and destroying our great country.
Right, thank you to all the candidates. I'm going to hand over to Lisa now. Just one thing before I do. Lisa has spent hours and hours and evenings and weekends and sleepless nights putting this together. What a fantastic hustings this is. How many people are in this room? 500, 600 people. Well done to Lisa. Thank you very much.
Okay, guys, just before we go to our first question, I'll need to tell you something that's happening next week. So the NCS students in college are doing an amazing thing. They're collecting food for the Trussell Trust. So if you have donated items that you could give to the food banks for the homeless, then we're looking for those to come into college from the 11th to the 18th. And there's going to be something on the bulletin, there's going to be posters around college of recommended items. But if you can donate one item to help somebody over Christmas, that would be amazing. So I'm just letting you know that in advance. Okay, so we had over 60 questions sent in by you guys. So when people tell me that young people don't care about politics, I tell them that they're not telling the truth, because I know you care. And Dave and I sat down yesterday and we whittled these questions down to 7. And it's going to be really tight. We may even only get 5 in. So we're going to hand over to students who are going to actually pose the question, and then 2 of the party candidates are going to answer. They are going to be timed because we do want you to have the right to reply. Okay, so question 1 is from Claudia Gratian, who is a year 12.
So my question is, with more focus on mental health in the recent years, what will you be doing locally for young people regarding their mental health and the support they can receive? And that is for Rob and Darren, please.
Claudia, thank you. thank you very much for that question. Mental health is a subject dear to my heart because I've had family members and friends who have suffered with mental health. Also, I was involved as a mentor for a forces charity called Serve On, where we had mentorship for people with post-traumatic stress disorder. So it's a really, really important subject. The Conservative Party are committed to putting in £2.3 billion extra into mental health services. But that won't be enough on its own. We need to do more on that. We really need to be genuine that mental health is treated in the same way as physical health. Now you can imagine coming in with a broken leg, getting an assessment, and they say to you, okay, we'll come back to you in 2 months to do a further assessment. It's not good enough. For mental health, we need to have immediate action. We need to have early intervention. That is really, really key to trying to support this and solve this problem. And also there's a huge knock-on to other services. A good example was I was out doing a ride-along with police, and the PC that was driving said, how much time do you think I spend on crime? Got the number hopelessly wrong. And she said 11%. 66% is on mental health. So there's a knock-on. We do need to solve this problem, and the Conservatives are going to try and make sure that we inject £2.3 billion and also treat it the same way as physical health.
Thank you very much. So I'm 46 years old, and yeah, I know, it's very old indeed. Three of my friends that I was at university with have committed suicide in the last 3 years. So I have personal experience of this. Mental health is a problem for people of all ages, all genders. I would say that young people are facing so many challenges right now, and there's an epidemic of self-harm, a lot of it driven by social media. The question is, what are we going to do locally for young people and young people's mental health? Well, I've already said about the $6 billion that we want to put into mental health services by putting a penny on income tax. None of the other parties will tell you where that money is coming from. So it's not real money, so don't believe it. Now, I also think there's two things that we can do to improve young people's mental health. Firstly, by providing job opportunities, and secondly, by providing secure and affordable housing, both of which the current Tory government have totally failed to do. And I think I'm going to leave it there.
Wanting to come back to either of the politicians about that question. Anybody got anything to say? Claudia.
So if the pressure is on housing, what are you going to do about schools? What support are we going to get there for mental health? And with the NHS, where are you getting that 1p on income tax from? Not everyone can afford that. I know it's only 1p, but not everyone can.
Okay, so I'll come to your second point first, which is when we were in government, the Liberal Democrats took about 6-7 million people out of tax altogether. We raised the income tax threshold to £11,500. It was previously £8,500. So we believe in taking low-income people out of tax. If you ask me, I think that someone that is earning the minimum wage should not pay income tax at all. But the thing is, if you want to properly fund the NHS, it's something that we all use, then you have to do it through the basic rate of income tax. It's a fantasy to say that by going after billionaires and Amazon and Google, there's this pot of gold. The government has been trying to do this for 10, 15 years. The money isn't there. It will disappear. It's like trying to grab quicksilver. I believe, as a liberal, in the social contract. If it's something that we all use, like the NHS, we should all contribute to it and not expect somebody else to pay. Sorry if that answer doesn't please you.
Okay, thank you guys. We're going to have to move on to the next question. I know what the politicians want to say, but we need to move on. Our next question is from Camilla Nouri, who is a year 12.
report to the police. What do you think has led to this recent rise, and what will your party do to tackle such hate crimes as homophobia and racism? And my question is to Anna Soubry and Greg Marshall, please.
Thank you. I wish your question wasn't true, but unfortunately it is true. And we know there was a particular spike in hate crime straight after the referendum. Look, the reality, as I was trying to explain in my speech, is that I think we have a really serious problem now. We've got the growth of an extremism, not just in the two main parties, but just generally. And I think what Brexit did was it sort of lifted up the stone and some very unpleasant and nasty stuff crawled out. And then it's been, unfortunately, it's been fueled by a right-wing press often that has thought it was acceptable to call people like me traitors and mutineers. And as a result of that, which some people seem to think, again, is very funny, and I don't know why, because the result of that is politicians like me and our families have suffered from death threats and threats generally on a scale that we have never seen before. And it's also linked with this rise of populism, fueled again by a media that's lost the plot. And you see what's happened in America with the election of Donald Trump, who has to be one of the most dangerous and odious politicians that the world's seen for a long, long time. But what he and people like Farage feed off is they feed off preying on people's prejudices and their fears. And you see that in this election. And it's up to politicians to call out the extremism and to stand up to the racism, the homophobia, and all the things that I thought in my lifetime we'd seen the back of, which are now resurging. If you vote for somebody like me, I'll continue to stand up to the abuse and the threats, and I'll stand up for what I believe is decent and right, and speak truth to power.
What we have to be careful of is asking those who have been part of the problem to solve it. Now, Anna Soubry, of course, was an architect of the lurch to the far right that this country has seen over the last 8 and 9 years. Not too far away from here, about 10 years ago, just over 10 years ago, the British National Party got elected in the borough of Broxton. And I formed an organisation called Nottinghamshire Stop the BNP. And we marched on the streets and we pushed them back and we stopped the British National Party from having their Red, White and Blue Festival in a place called Codner. And I received death threats and I had police protection and my kids received death threats for that. And when the EDL, came to Nottingham, it was the Labour Party and the Labour movement that marched against them. And make no mistake, when we are fast and loose with words like extremism, when they come back in this period of far-right resurgence and an emboldenment of racism and fascism, it will only be the Labour Party and the trade union movement that is there to defeat them, like before, like every time, and you never ever see Tory banners on anti-far-right demonstrations. You never see them fighting the EDL. You never see them pushing them back. The Labour Party will revise the Prevent agenda. The Labour Party stands with those who are oppressed. It stands with those who face oppression for LGBT issues. It is the party of self-determination. It is the party of anti-racism, now and into the future. Stay with Labour and they will push the haters back.
Claudia, sorry. Miller, have you anything you want to say back, or has that answered your question? Okay, so, third question.
And Rob.
our economy to a new level. We need to do it now. 2030 ain't good enough. 2050 ain't good enough. Action needs to happen now in climate change. This is why it's now or never. We have to do it now.
I've only got a minute and a half, but I just want to add that as part of the party that introduced equal marriage in this country, we also stand against hate crime. Now, the question was about climate change. I think I partially answered it at the start. We have, as part of the Paris Agreement, to reach a zero carbon economy by 2050. We want to set a more ambitious target to achieve that by 2045. That is going to involve major changes in how we all live. Now, in order to do that, we need to get 80% of our energy from renewables by 2030. This is a very ambitious target. Now, I already mentioned earlier about when we were in coalition, we increased that from 3% to 20%. We have a track record on this. Nobody else does. It's all very well to deal in sound bites and shout your policies and glue your hands to a bus, which happened to our electric bus the other day. You need to have a track record in doing this. In order to decarbonize the economy, you have to promote renewables and you have to reduce demand. That is why we want to insulate all low-income homes by 2025. That could reduce... Thank you. As well as giving people warmer homes, it will save them money on their energy bills. Also, we want to completely eliminate single-use plastics while we were in coalition. Thank you. While we were in coalition, we dragged the Tories kicking and screaming into a 5p bag tax, which they opposed. It has 80% reduced the use of plastic carrier bags. So we have a track record in doing this. And I think I will leave it there. That was more than a minute and a half.
Thanks, Rob. Has anybody wanted to come back to either of those comments? Okay. Oh, yeah? Yeah?
You're sitting there saying that you want to change by 2030. I agree with Brent Poland. Why can't we do it now? Why is it 10, 12 years ahead? Tell us why!
I absolutely agree, but in order to move away from coal and gas, you have to build new power stations. So there is a huge new nuclear power station now under construction in the southwest. We promoted all of those things, solar. Every time you see someone with solar panels on their roof, that's because of a subsidy that the Liberal Democrats introduced during the coalition. Right, okay? We have a track record on this.
Thanks, Rob. Okay. Gosh, to get through these questions, I'm so sorry you're not getting a lot of chance to come back. But question number four is from Rebecca. Where are you, Rebecca? We need to get you.
To just come back on something that Labour's candidate said, calling me an architect of extremism. I was marching with the anti-Nazi League when he was in Nappers. But addressing your particular question, let me just say this. I think the biggest threat that our country faces, in addition to the climate crisis, is actually our economy. And my view is that if we do Brexit, especially if we follow through with Boris Johnson's Brexit, then that will have huge impacts on our economy. And all of us, we all want a thriving economy for all sorts of good reasons, with the provision of jobs, good wages, and of course the taxes to pay for public services. But whichever way you do Brexit, it will harm our economy. That's why I want that people's vote. That's why I don't want us to leave the European Union. And if we can stay in the European Union, which is the best deal, by the way, that we have with the European Union, then we can begin to rebuild the prosperity that we need to make sure that we can continue to provide good jobs for everybody. But there to be faced, because in this election, you've got the two main parties making all sorts of promises to you, largely unfunded, or that can only be paid for by yet more debt. And at the end of the day, there are no magic trees that produce money. All that money comes from one source, and that's the people of this country, so we've got to get the balance right.
Okay, Darren, I'm going to ask you to be really specific on the answer, and the question was, how are you going to, if you come into power, how are you going to tackle and decrease child poverty in the UK? That was the question.
As Anna said there, it's really, really important that you have a strong economy to start with. In 2010, we took over from a terrible financial situation, and that caused us to have to make responsible decisions in terms of having budget. You've got to balance the books. You can't spend what you don't have. It's the same true in a household as it is for a government. So it's really, really important that we had to make those tough decisions. But in terms of the future going forward, yes, get Brexit done, because we don't want to be just talking about Brexit. But also, once we've got that done, we can then concentrate on the wider agenda that we've got planned for the growth of our country. Now, 90% of the growth for our country in export is expected to be outside of the EU. So we have a great opportunity going forward in terms of exports, great for local businesses in terms of cutting taxes for businesses. And when we do that, businesses create jobs. Businesses create jobs, and jobs are the route out of poverty. Also making sure that in terms of education, there are training pathways. There are training pathways that include apprenticeships and university places as well, so that there are options to get jobs. Green jobs are very important. If you work in something like a wind farm, creating jobs is a route out of poverty.
Is the family unit, and what I've not heard from anyone here is how you're going to promote stable and healthy family living. How are you going to make sure those families have a nice place to live and they can care for their children? Because that is one of the biggest things that will help solve child poverty.
Your solution to let's just make more jobs. Look at all these families who are working 0-hour contracts. You class that as a job. Make proper jobs.
And that point there is a perfect segue into our next question, okay? So our fifth question. Actually, guys, this, you need to notice this guy. This is the head of our politics society here in society, does really well. So Jack's question.
Hi, so this question is directed at Greg and Brooke. So, considering the fact that employment is such a key issue for young people all over this country, how do your respective parties intend to balance the need for employers to hire more young people with your policies on working conditions and pay?
For the last 9 years, years, the economy has stagnated and we've seen a proliferation of zero-hour contracts, low pay, rubbish pay, in-work poverty, and a de-skilling of the workforce. The Labour Party is going to end zero-hour contracts. Job at work. I had a friend who was on the bus the other day going to work. On the bus to work, he got told by his boss, don't need you anymore, had to go back, loses his shift. Has mortgage uncertainty, rent uncertainty. We're going to scrap 0 hours. We're going to grow the economy by paying everybody £10 an hour, no matter what the job. Don't forget, the Tories told you that couldn't be done when we introduced the minimum wage first time around. Do not believe that the economy can't sustain a £10 minimum wage where we all can earn, where we all can benefit, where we all can buy from shops and have more money in the pocket. As for Broxtowe, I tell you what we're going to do. We're going to make Broxtowe the heart of the manufacturing regeneration of the East Midlands. We're going to have Derby, Rolls-Royce and Bombardier one end, high-skilled manufacturing, high-paid, high-skilled jobs. We're going to have high-skilled pharmaceuticals and academia at the other end, at the Nottingham end. And slap bang in the middle of that, we're going to have Broxtowe with a HS2 hub and our fair share of a £250 billion investment bank. And then we're going to say Broxtowe has been let down for too long. It's about time we had apprenticeships, skilled vocational work, valued our academics, and together we will grow the economy. Only Labour has the vision on that. Only Labour is offering you a real alternative. So to support the Labour Party and grow the economy.
Plagiarism is a form of flattery, so I thank the Labour Party for promoting our policies as usual. We are about social mobility. Thanks for that, I agree. Thank you for promoting our green agenda as well. And thank you, Anna, for all of your talking about equality. The original and the best. We want a 4-day working week. We want quality of life guarantee. I work 70-hour weeks. I'm going back to a lesson this afternoon. I've marked mock exams. I had 2 lessons this morning. I'm running myself ragged as a social public sector worker. I'm not even public sector any longer. My boss is a CEO. We don't have lives any longer. We're in a rat race. A race to the bottom. And as for Broxtowe and HS2, I know where you can shove it. Because local people have been abused on that. You let down the viewers, you let down Trowell, you abused the people of Trowell, you've sold out, Jeremy Corbyn has sold out the people of Broxtowe, because the unions, boys and girls, have the unions have Labour where they want them. You cut your Corbyn cortex because the unions got you. I have no puppet strings on me. The unions do not control me, nor do the rich bankers, nor do all the vested interests. I put the £500 deposit myself up to stand in a general election like my Green colleagues. There is no swamp where I am. So I'm sorry all these promises. I will stand for what is right for people. And all people. A fair economy where we have a life, not a life of debt.
Do you want to come back on that, Jack?
You're damn right, I'm against the HS2.
Whoa, thank you. Jack gets the floor right now.
Thank you very much for your responses to that question.
Okay, can we just have a bit of respect for our students, please, so that they can come back? Jack.
Thank you very much for your response to that question. My response to you would be, where is the incentive for small businesses and big businesses to hire more young people when they're effectively having to over double the minimum wage of young people overnight? Where is that incentive? I can't see it.
So we're going to create a £250 billion investment bank and divvy that up into regions to make access to funds, access to growth, easier for businesses, easier for businesses, which of course the Tories, and of course Anna when she was at the helm, didn't allow. She didn't mind bailing out the banks, but she was happy for our high streets to stagnate. So we're going to offer £250 billion worth of investment bank. In terms of, we're going to give
increased grants to shop fronts, early startups. We're trying to do stuff on business rates to have the business rate retention for local authorities rather than hiving it off to central government. Of course, the Tories blocked that, of course. The Tories blocked the initiative, particularly in Broxton, which was due to be a pilot for increased business rate retention, which allows more investment locally because the local authority can then drive. We've tried it, we were blocked. So when the Labour Party's in power, we'll change the legislation to allow that retention, to allow more money to be invested into local businesses.
Okay, so there's just one more thing for you guys to do. At the back of the room, there is a voting ballot box. As you leave the refectory, not yet, in a minute, I want you to take a ballot and I want you to make your mark on it. We've got staff and students willing to help you with that. And we're going to do a mock election. So on what you've heard and what you think, we want you...